started high school when I was 11 years old. And when I was a senior, I was 14. I became 15 in October, so I was 15 when I graduated in May. And, of course, I had no thoughts of going into the military because the war hadn't even started then. But it did start soon after I graduated. I graduated in May and it started in December. But I was still 15. So I was 2 years away from when they really accepted me. And I worked at home. Actually, you couldn't work in a factory till you were 16. There's no way they'd let you in one. So I had another year or so before I could even go to work away from home. But I did everything at home then, running the farm. And Dad actually took a job working for the highway department. And I pretty much saw that everything got done there. And he had a couple people working for him, hired hands as well, Whitaker and Jack Smith. So I did that for 2 years. It was kind of lonely there in the wintertime because everybody, all the other kids my age were going to school and I was at home. But I had plenty to do, so it wasn't too bad. I had told my parents that I was going to go join the Marine Corps as soon as I was eligible. They didn't want me to, but I'm a pretty stubborn kid and they knew that I was going to do it anyway, so they finally agreed, well, go ahead. And about August 1 or 2 or something like that, I went down to Cincinnati and walked in the post office. They had a recruit booth there for the Marine Corps, and I signed up August 43. Went back home, continued to work on the farm, did everything. There until October. And on about October 15th, I got a notice from the Marine Corps to report to Paris Island on October 20th, which happened to be my birthday. The day I turned 18, I reported to Paris Island. I found Paris Island, the physical part of it was no challenge. It was just not that tough. I worked harder at home than what I saw down there in Paris Island. The psychological part of it, with the drill instructor yelling in your face, that took some adjustment. But my theory always was, if the other people had done this, and I think at that time there had probably been, since my serial number in the Marine Corps was 514-716, that means that there's only been a half a million Marines in the whole Peru career of the Marine Corps, 200 years, in the first 200 years. So I thought, if those guys can handle this, this old boy can handle it too. That was always my thought, and so I did. I didn't have a great deal of difficulty with Paris Island boot camp. Out of boot camp, went in on October and got out at the end. And I was home for Christmas, so I don't know exact day. I think about the 20th probably. I was left there and came home, and I remember spending the week of the holidays I was home. I reported back to Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, which was a training camp for Marines. They had an intelligence school there. I always wondered why they sent me to intelligence school. I thought I was smart enough. reasonably smart, but that's where I went, was to intelligence school. And it was kind of fun there. We'd go on night treks out through the forest there in Pine Forest in North Carolina and look for things, and it was a games really, but I learned some of the symbols so I could tell what regiment, if there was a dead Japanese soldier, I could look at his insignias and tell what group he was probably with, that kind of stuff. I didn't retain much of that. I don't remember very little about that, but that's one of the things we were obligated to do. We were there about 6 weeks, as I remember. Left there and headed for Hawaii. We went to Norfolk, Virginia, and got on the biggest ship I'd ever seen, the James O'Hara. And it was just a big transport. It wasn't exceptionally big, but it was by far the biggest one I'd ever seen. I think that ship was probably 8-10 years old. It wasn't an old ship, but it wasn't brand new either. And there were about 500 White Marines and 1,500 Black Marines on that. First time I'd seen a Black Marine, a Negro Marine. The roughest water I saw in the next 2 years, and I was on 16 ships before I finally got back, the roughest water I saw was right there out of Norfolk, Virginia. Waves looked like five-story building rolling across that statue of the ship. And of the 2,000 troops on that ship, everybody was seasick. I never upchucked like practically everybody did, but I sure in hell didn't eat much for 3 or 4 days. Finally got over it though. You can't imagine how bad that ship was with the vomit that was every place. But finally we made it out. In about a week or 10 days, I think it took us a little over a week to get to Panama Canal. We headed through it, and back to the O'Hara. It only had salt water on it. They had drinking water, but the showers and everything were just pumped out of the ocean. And when we got to the Panama Canal, the Lake Gatlin, which really is the water you get into when you're in the Panama Canal, is fresh water. And that felt so good to be hosed down with fresh water after 10 days of salt water and under conditions that you can't believe, from the odors and everything, from the sickness. One nitwit Marine got killed going through the canal. He was supposed to keep everybody away from the boat davits. They're the rigs that lower the boats over the side. And the O'Hara had about 10 landing craft on each side. And anyway, I guess that Marine did a reasonably good job of keeping everybody else away from them while they were lowering the boats. Let me go back. They had to lower the boats because the canal locks weren't wide enough for the ship to go through with the boats hanging on the side, so they had to take the boats off the side to get the ship through the canal. And but anyway, the Marine was killed there. First dead man I'd seen in the war. He got eaten in the davit, where he was supposed to keep everybody else away, so he ended up dying. On to the Pacific Ocean. I think I always always thought that the Panama Canal runs east and west to connect the Pacific and Atlantic, but it doesn't. To go from the Atlantic to the Pacific, you really sail a little bit southeast, if you can believe that, across the isthmus there. Pacific Ocean, it's altogether different than Atlantic. It was just smooth as that pool table there. And another 10 days to get to Pearl Harbor. We went into a transit center, which was where they located Marines while they decided what to do with them, where to assign them. And after we were there two or three days, I was called in along with about 60 other people, interviewed to see if we fit to join an amphibious reconnaissance battalion. And that is landing from rubber boats in the hostile shores, getting the hell out of there and take the boat back out. And I, of course, said, sure, well, I can do it. If anybody else, I said to myself, if they can do it, I can do it. And so I was taken into that reconnaissance group. That would have been late February, 1st of March. And we trained there in the Pearl Harbor area, Oahu, for two or three months. We'd go out to Nanakuli Beach, take those rubber boats out, the biggest surf I've ever seen, 10, 12 foot surf there all the time practically. I think it's on the northwest corner of Oahu. I'm not sure which corner, but I think that's where it is. And trained there. One of the experiences when we first went out there, in the interview they'd ask if we could swim, and yet had to be able to swim because they wouldn't let you out of boot camp if you couldn't swim. But of course I hadn't learned to swim before that. But the biggest body of water I'd ever swam in was Coney Island, just outside Cincinnati. Twice I had been there, and that was the biggest pool I'd ever been in. Anyway, they asked us there if we could swim, and to join that outfit, you had to be able to swim. Went out to the beach, and there was a Marine warrant officer. Appeared to be 55 or 60, huge man. When he got in the water, he was just like big walrus. Could just completely at ease in the water. And he could stand in the water, I swear, and his head would be out. He didn't seem to flinch a muscle. He'd just stand there and his head sticking out. But he was to make us comfortable in the water and to train us with it. So he said, well, we're going to swim out into the ocean here a mile, and then we're going to turn left and swim 2 miles, and then we're going to turn left again and swim back into the beach. So that's a 4 mile swim. Hardest I'd ever swam in my life was probably 50 yards. But I soon found that swimming in the salt water is easier because you're more buoyant. You won't really sink if you just don't panic in salt water. So we made it, most of us made it. I think out of them, there were probably about 100 of us at that point that made that swim. And they had a boat along, a couple boats with us. And two guys got leg cramps and had to be pulled out of the water, but the rest of us made the 4 mile swim. And that old warrant officer, I forgot his name, he showed us how to swim in the ocean. And he said, you can swim a long time out here if you just don't panic and do what I'm telling you. And we swam the breaststroke mostly. We just use the breaststroke and keep going. And after a couple swims like that, I think I could have stayed afloat in the ocean for two or three days if I had to. I know I could have, there's no question about it. So and a lot of sailors and Marines that were on suction ships found that they could too. You can stay afloat a long time if you don't panic and just keep at it. Anyway, that was part of our training there. That we were heading for the Marianas, which compose primarily Saipan, Tinian, and Guam, and that we were going to join the 1st Battalion, 2nd Marines on the way out there, and we were to go in with our rubber boats into Majusinga Bay on the southeast side of Saipan, and the 2nd Marine Regiment, Battalion, was going to follow us in. And then we were all going to move right up to the top of the ridge there so we could control the top of the ridge while the major landing was made the next morning. Sounded like pure suicide to me and everybody else. There were 24,000 Japanese on that island, and total we were about 280, I think, of us going in there. That was included the 2nd Marines Battalion. We were on the USS Waters, I think it was. A World War II, no, World War I destroyer that had four stacks, and they took out two of the stacks, put in better engines, more efficient engines, and used those space where they took out the two stacks for troop compartments, and that's where we were. There were 120 of us on that ship, and we were on there. It was rather compact in the troop departments, and practically no deck space. And no deck space at all for Marines when there was general quarters, which means that the ship's crew were on alert, which they were on alert every morning for 2 hours and every evening for 2 hours, because I guess the submarines found it easier to attack ships at the beginning of the day and the end, and I think it's because the ships tend to be silhouetted against the sky. If you're in a submarine, you need the silhouette to see the ships better. I think that's why they went to general quarters every day and every morning. And occasionally during the day, if the sonar picked up a sound like a submarine. And of course, we were down below. We never were on deck when they were on general quarters. About halfway out to the Marianas, which was a 2-week trip. Tokyo Rose, the American woman who broadcast for the Japanese out of Tokyo, announced that the 2nd Marine Battalion, 1st Battalion, 2nd Marines, reinforced, had left Pearl Harbor and was heading for Majusinga Bay. So not only now, that surely heightened our anxiety, because they knew we were coming and we were 280 against 24,000. Plus they had tanks. That got a little scary. But they never told us anything, and we were still going. Of course we were going, and I would have gone over the side just like the rest of them did, if necessary. But we got out there to Saipan. We could see the island the day before when we were offshore, probably 5 miles or something, just barely see it. And then they announced that we weren't going ashore with the 2nd Marines. Neither would the 2nd Marines go ashore. main assault was going to be on the west side of the island. And it would be the next morning. And Magazine Bay was on the east side. And this was just to draw all the Japanese tanks and everything over to Magazine Bay so they wouldn't be facing the ones on the west side. And it worked. Very few tanks on the west side when the Marines went ashore that day. So the whole thing was a charade, and we're still alive. We went ashore in the second wave then the next morning in Saipan on the west shore. There were shells landing considerably. Well, before we went ashore, they served us breakfast, which was traditional of steak and eggs. We never got steak and eggs except when you were getting ready to go ashore. And steak and eggs, I liked it. I really did. But it always tasted like iron to me. The steak always tasted like iron. I never quite figured that out and whether other people had that problem or not, but they did to me. Anyway, we got loaded up on proteins and shore, landed, we went ashore in an Amtrak, and that's an amphibious tractor, and got within about, there were some reefs in the water there, and the Amtraks had trouble climbing over those sometimes, and we got within about 50 yards probably of the shore, and it got stuck up on that reef, and they lowered the ramp in front and we bailed out of there. And the water was about hip deep in there. That's all. It wasn't over our barrels. It was below that. And so you wade ashore there. And of course, you get your feet a little damp doing that. And you're not going to stop and dry them off for 2 days. So anyway, we got ashore. And on the beach, the sand beyond the beach went up in a mound of sand. They're about 10 feet high, I guess, a little higher than that. But you could walk up it easy. It was just a big sand dune. And started up that. And at that time, there were some bullets flying over our heads. They weren't, they couldn't get to us, but the sandbank was protecting us. And we flopped down there on the ocean side of that bank to get oriented and collect into proper groups. And there was a Marine laying there. I could reach out and touch him, and he was dead. And it looked to me like he'd been shot right in the forehead. Probably in the first wave. We were in the second. About minutes after that, we went up over the top and moved in. And once you got up over the ridge, we were again sheltered somewhat because it was not perfectly smooth. There was, you could run and crawl along there, and the bullets, most of them, once in a while, they weren't often, but you could hear them going over our heads there. Don't remember exactly what the rest of the day was until the evening. I never fired a shot, never saw a Japanese that first day. But of course, our job wasn't frontline troops. We were there to help reconnoiter whenever needed, and really to guard the official, the station command post, is what I'm trying to say. And we finally, they set up where that was going to be, and we set up a security around it. And we were about, I'd say, 800 or 1,000 yards from the beach there. And everybody had run out of drinking water, because all we carried ashore was a quart canteen. And it was hot there. We were talking about the 14th day of June in the tropics, so it was, you sweat a lot, and drank water, and pretty soon nobody had any water. And we were stopped up there, just sitting around the sidewalk, waiting for somebody to tell us the next move. And, well, somebody needs to go down and get some water from the beach. They've got it down there. So, okay, I'll go. Litch, three of us went. I'd forgotten who the third was, but I know it was Litch. And we went down to the back, walked down to the beach, and I said to my fire group, I said, I'm leaving my rifle here. You guys hang on to it. I'm going to carry water back. I'm not carrying that rifle. And the other two did the same thing. I don't know why they let us. Somebody should have said, don't do that. And believe me, I never did it again. But anyway, we got down to the beach and started back up. I was carrying a 5-gallon can, just like a gas can off of a 6-by truck, of water on my shoulder, and headed back up there, and the artillery started, some shells started flying in at us. The Japanese still had the high ground, and they could reach us with their, they're probably 105s, something like that. They weren't huge shells, but they were scary as could be. And I'd hear one of those coming, and I never set that can down. I just jumped out from under it, and it hit the ground about the same time I did. I remember doing that 2 or 3 times, but none of us in our group got hurt from it anyway. Got back to where we'd left the rest of them, and they're gone. And I don't remember the exact details, but we found them a half hour later or something, and they'd moved into a grove of trees, little trees, about 15 feet high. And I, of course, hunted up Jack Webby, the guy that I left my rifle with in my fire group, and he didn't have it. He had his own, but he didn't have mine, and didn't have Litch's either. So it was getting dusk, and they said, well, this is where we're going to spend the night, so you better start digging a foxhole. And of course, you carried your digging tool on your back, so we had a tool, just a little shovel. And that worked pretty good, digging that dirt for the first 6 inches, but then it was coral, and it didn't work worth a damn then. So we scraped out a little shallow place there, and Litch and I, we dug an L-shaped foxhole, so our feet were together, and our heads separate. No weapons. Jack, who hadn't carried a rifle, so I wanted to shoot him. If I'd had a gun, I probably would have, and I should have. Anyway, he had a sidearm that he'd stolen while we were aboard ship. Or someplace. Anyway, from an army group. He had a 45. And so he loaned us that 45, so that was the only weapon Litch and I had that night in the front line there. And we're laying there. These rifle fire, probably a machine gun up ahead of us a little ways, firing at us, not ours. The bullets were flying through those trees, but they were up above us by 2 feet or so. So as long as you stayed down, it didn't feel bad. I lost track of time there, but sometime in the night, and it wasn't daylight yet, I think it was probably 2 or 3 in the morning, a mortar shell hit right in the trees over our head. It was 12 feet from where I was laying, right up in front of over my head. And Litch said, I think that one got me, Curly. I wasn't hit by it, but it was right there. And I said, well, how bad? And he said, I don't think it's serious, but we need to manage it. He was just like that, just as calm as could be. And I said, okay. So I slid over there towards him, and he he had his, we had each one have a medical kit carried. And we broke his out. We carried a sulfa drug to hold up the infection. Broke open that package and sprinkled that on it. The piece of shrapnel had gone through his hand. And got the bandage out and wrapped it up. Didn't seem to be bleeding seriously, but there was a gap there. It just wasn't that big a problem bleeding, but there was something. Anyway, we endured the rest of the night there. And the next, then of course, he was evacuated out to a hospital ship that morning. And we didn't see him then until we got back to Pearl Harbor 3 months later. The hospital ship collected many wounded as they could haul and headed back to Pearl Harbor. So I still don't have a rifle. Litch didn't need one because he was aboard the hospital ship, but I still didn't have one. So there was an army group of engineers back of us a ways there that next morning. I don't know, it's probably while we were looking for, I don't remember the exact circumstances, but I saw this man, an army man, lay his carbine down and walk away from it. So I just went over and picked it up and got the hell out of there. I stole that carbine and I carried it the rest of the war. Of course, my ammunition belt was for M1, so the ammunition I had didn't fit the carbine. But you could find ammunition belts and stuff like that around because there were enough of them scattered. And I found one for a carbine, and so I appropriated that, threw down my M1 belt. As I said, survived the rest of the war with that carbine. We were on Saipan then. For the rest of the month, that'd be 2 weeks there, I'd say we were on Saipan for the rest of June. I don't remember the exact time, maybe 3 weeks. We never really were exposed on the front lines. That was the line outfits of the 2nd and 4th Marine Divisions that were up there. And they carried a lot of heavier armor than we had, so we mopped up, searched some houses and villages and things, but we weren't in the front lines after that first night we were there. One of the missions we had one day, our platoon was set up there in the hills, but the Marine Divisions had already taken those hills, but it was rugged country. There were caves and coral outcroppings and a lot of things, and there somebody had been up there and they reported there were still some Japanese up in those hills. And so they, as a platoon, we went up there on patrol one day looking for the wandering Japanese, and we didn't find them. We found evidence of them, little fires where they'd been cooking at night or cooking something, and where they'd spent the night, but we never found any Japanese. But we did find some dead ones, and one of the projects was to get rid of the dead men. In the meantime, one of the other assignments we had there was to guard the compound where the prisoners of war were held. And there were no Japanese prisoners of war, but the Koreans who had been brought in there as labor battalions. They didn't want to fight, they wanted to quit, and nobody blamed them for that, nevertheless, I couldn't tell the difference between a Japanese and a Korean, and so those guys were thrown into the stockade. And when we wanted, they were willing to work, and when we had burial details, patrol, and we found a bunch of bodies up there in the hills, so they had to be buried, and we needed some Korean. So the next day, okay, Connor, do you remember where those bodies were? And I said, yeah, I remember where they were. And okay, you go with this bunch of Koreans. They had two MPs, military policemen, to guard the Koreans. And I was the one who was to show them where the bodies were. And we take off on another 2 or 3 mile hike up in the hills there. And while we're up there, about the general area where the bodies were, here come two Navy officers. They might have been CBs, but they have something to do with the Navy. I don't remember. I think they come running down this little trail through the jungle at us, and they were all excited that they just run into a Japanese up there, and they thought they'd shot him. So I said, well, where is it? And they said, we're up there and about 50 yards and then down the hill a little bit to the right. So I went up there with the whole group of us went up that way. And I looked down about 12 feet down over a little coral precipice there, and it was jungle all around. And there was a body, or there was something down there. I could see part of a uniform. So I said to those two MPs, I said, well, cover me the best you can. I'll go down there and see if that guy's dead. And the way it worked out that those two Navy people had shot him. But they didn't know whether they killed him or not. So anyway, I climbed down through there, and that was pretty hairy because it was dense jungle, and I got down there and I'm squatted down beside him, and his body's still warm. He'd only been dead for 6 minutes at the most. And I remember squatting down there and looking around every direction, trying to make sure I didn't get hit and shot again, shot by somebody that was there. And of course, booby traps on Japanese was always a problem. They put a hand grenade under the guy's arm, so if you picked up his arm, the grenade would go off and you'd blow you all up. You had to be very cautious in that situation, which I was, extremely cautious. And this Japanese he was an officer. I don't remember the rank. I don't think I was at Newton. I should have known how to distinguish that, but I didn't know. Major, I think he was equivalent of a major. And he had an elaborate leather briefcase hanging on him, on straps on his body, and a body harness with a fancy holster, covered holster, and a pistol, obviously, in that. And most of this equipment was pretty bloody. So I just took my K-bar, that was the knife I carried, and cut the straps off of the pistol holster and grabbed it and got it out of there. And I brought that pistol home with me. I still have it. I wasn't allowed to do that. I should have turned it in. So everybody told me, you know, that was the instructions. You didn't carry the Japanese weapons around. But I wanted it, so I hid it. And most of the people in my platoon knew I had it. And they didn't. They weren't going to tell on me. And I know that our Lieutenant Taylor, who was our officer, sooner or later he knew I had that pistol. Maybe that same day. And he was a very understanding person, and he said, well, keep it out of sight and don't tell me any more about it. So that's what I did. And when I got back to Pearl, a little more on the pistol, we're heading out to Okinawa, and I didn't want to carry it because the hell, it was too hard to conceal all the time, so I thought I wouldn't need something to do it. So on the boat over from Virginia, I had gotten acquainted with a Sergeant Onsberger from West Virginia. And I think he was in charge of the group that I was in then, because I was a private then. And we all were practically that came out of boot camp. Anyway, he was stationed there in Pearl Harbor in some capacity. I've forgotten what it was. Might have had something to do with mailing or something, mailed. But he was permanent there. And so I went to him and said, look, I got this pistol out, and I don't want to carry it on another mission because I'll never get back with it. And I said, I want to leave it with you. And he said, sure, I'll take care of it for you. So I turned it over to him. And when I got back 7 months later, he had it for me. That's the way I got home with that pistol. Type pistol that I recovered from the Japanese major that I was dragging out of the jungle there. I wasn't allowed to carry a Japanese weapon, and I had to hide this from everybody for the rest of my career in the Marine Corps. Can you see it there? About a 10-shot Luger type. I'm no expert on weapons, but everybody who's supposed to know about it said it was a very good weapon. The island of Tinian is a few miles south of Saipan. You can easily see one island from the other one. And the next objective of the Marine Corps was to take Tinian. It was decided that the Saipan was so hilly that it didn't lend itself for airfields, and the main purpose of taking the Mariana Islands was to get airfields that they could use the B-29 bombers on to bomb Japan. So Tinian was the next objective, and Tinian is a long island, 20-something miles long, and the good beaches are all in the south end of the island. The rest of the coasts are rock cliffs about 12, 15 feet high. And the aerial photos they'd taken of the place showed that up on the western corner of beach of Tinian, there was a crack in the cliff that at least it was a footpath. That's what it looked like in the photos, that people had been walking up and down to get to the beach. And six of us went in there one night to take a closer look at the crack in the cliffs to see if it could be used to, if it could be expanded wide enough to get a tank through it. That's what was the idea was. And I was chosen. I think the main reason I ended up on that trip was because I was about the only one in our platoon that didn't have a dengue fever then. And so I can't think of another reason they would have chosen me, because the crew was me, a sergeant, Rogers, who was my sergeant most of the time, and four officers. But it didn't include Lieutenant Taylor, who was my officer, because he had dengue fever and couldn't make the trip. Anyway, we boarded a destroyer from Saipan, and about midnight or something around that, we went over the side into a rubber boat. I think there were 7 or 8 of us, I can't remember exactly. But we were used to this kind of an operation, that's what we trained for. And they towed us behind a landing craft to within close to the beach, a couple hundred yards. No, we were farther than that. We were about 2,000 yards from the beach. And then we paddled on in to within about 200 yards of the beach. And Rogers and I stayed in the boat, and we were to keep the boat there, try to hold it against whatever tides there were, and the rest of them were swam into the beach to reconnoiter that little path up through the rocks. So we're sitting out there in the dark, and the problem was, how do you hold a boat in the pitch dark like that and be there when they swim back out? How would they find us? But we had a little help on that. In any case, in order to hold the boat there, we used a system called triangulation. We could see a little peak of land on each end of the island, or corner of it, and we kept those relatively the same, and then you can maintain your position reasonably close by doing that. And that's what we did there. To see, I lost the thought there. Anyway, we had a little device like a flashlight, about like a 4-battery flashlight, 3 or 4-battery flashlight, about a foot long or something like that, a little, more slender. And it fastened like a telescope on the end of a rifle around it. And if you had that, something ultra something ray, it shined a light. And when we pointed at the beach where the rest of the crew were, they had a similar scope and they could see our light. But nobody else could see it. You couldn't see it unless you were looking at it through that same kind of scope. And that's they had the light and we could watch for them. And when they were, we knew when they left the beach because they'd signaled us with that light. It was a flash or something. But nobody else could see it unless you were looking through the scope on the other end. First time those had been employed, at least first time my group had ever seen those things. And they did reconnoiter the beach, come swimming back out there, and we pulled them up in the rubber boat and started paddling out and were picked up and had breakfast that morning aboard the destroyer that picked us up, and that's where the landing on Tinian took place. The 20,000 troops on the island of Japanese were focused on the southern beaches, and the Marines landed on this little one-lane, by crossing one-lane bridge. A demolition team went in the next morning, and morning of the invasion, and blew that crack wider so you could get a tank or a truck up through it. Say we were in the first or second or third wave, because the Tinian was a long single line of Amtraks stretched about a mile out to sea, and you got in line, and when gotten in one at a time, so it wasn't a wave. But troops had been ashore an hour or so by the time we got ashore, and they had moved in several hundred yards by that time because there was practically no resistance there. Once the Japanese became aware of what we were doing, they did start throwing artillery at that little tiny crack up in the wall, because as we were approaching it in this line of Amtraks, there was a amphibious tractor. That's the vehicle that has rubber tires on the side and a screw propeller. It's amphibious truck is what it's called. It was sitting right near us, near the beach there, and a shell had hit in it just as we were right there. And I have a visual image of the two guys that were in it flying out through the air. Now it was an open, it wasn't like a tank where you got down the hole, it was an open cargo type thing. But I remember seeing those two guys flying out. But of course, we didn't stop, you just keep going. And, whether it killed them or not, I don't know. It probably did, but I never heard anything. Before the day was over there, the first line of Marines had moved inland about 5 or 6 miles because there was no resistance except artillery shells that they were throwing in that direction. And they had a hole in the line, a gap that needed plugged up there, so our company was moved up there. And in the meantime, I was just given a Browning automatic rifle to carry. I volunteered for it. And I think the total package was 40 pounds, including the rifle and the ammunition, on top of everything else you carry. And I walked that 6 miles up to the front. There were trucks moving up the road as well, but they were hauling food and ammunition to the front lines, and no troops. Maybe one or two guys on them, but not any number. Everybody had to walk. It was almost dark by the time we got up to the front line there, and the road we were on the left-hand side of the road, and there was another Marine outfit on the other side. Really didn't have any contact with them. We just saw them there, and it was getting dark, and we had to dig foxholes and get ready for the night. And there was a big shell, obviously, it could have been a bomb shell, or it could have been a Navy shell from the Navy guns. Had blown a hole about 4 feet across and 2 feet deep, right beside the road. And the soil there had about a foot of red soil and then coral underneath it. And this was white because the shell had penetrated into the rock coral and it just made a white hole. And everything else was deep red, looked like black at night. But I decided, Jack, who was my fire mate there, that we'd just use that shell hole rather than dig a foxhole. And we did. And that was a scary night because we were stuck out like a sore thumb in the night. You could see us and you couldn't see. There was a slight moon that night, as I recall. And just a little light. It wasn't pitch dark anyway. But that white hole we were in set us apart. The next morning, we looked like we'd been working in a flour mill. Our clothes were white, and everybody else was dirty red. And here we were covered with white dirt, white rock, or dust. That's the word I'm looking for. Never fired a shot that night. On the other side of the road, there was not a lot of firing, but occasional burst of fire over there. And there were 8 or 10 dead Japanese out in front of their side of the road. And as I say, we never fired a shot. But we never made contact on our left that night. So So we were sticking out there like a sore thumb because we never made contact with the lines on the right, on our left. And if the Japs had wanted to walk around our end, and there was only a platoon of us there, so we were only strung out there about 70 yards or something like that. Maybe, no, not even 70 or 80 yards. And if the Japs had wanted to walk around the end there, there's none to stop them. But they apparently didn't know that, and thank goodness. We survived that night. And the next morning then, a truck hauled us back down to the beach. And that's the last we saw of the front lines on Tinian. Again, our job was to hang around the headquarters there and do special assignments. And that we did. And one of the things I was asked to go on a burial detail. I guess we hadn't captured enough Koreans on Tinian at that point. And I don't think there were that many. I don't remember seeing very many Koreans on Tinian. But about six or eight of us laid out, 72 Marines and a few sailors in a common grave there on Tinian, and covered them. A bulldozer pushed the dirt in on them and covered them up. There was a guy there who was trying to keep track of who was buried there, and he had a record of it. Because when we'd carry a body in there and lay him down, we'd do the best we could to see his dog tag, and you'd pull one dog tag off and left the other one with him. And so there was a semblance of a record of who was in there. I can't remember. It seemed to me there was a couple of them that we couldn't find a tag on, so they were just laid out there, but I'm not real positive about that. That pretty well sums up Tinian. We were there about another week, I guess, and never got to the front lines on Tinian other than that first night there. Back aboard our destroyer, the World War I destroyer that took us out there in the USS Waters, and headed back to Pearl Harbor, which took us another week or so to get back to Pearl Harbor. We're back in Pearl. September. I think September, I can't remember the year, early or late. Sort of regrouped, got new equipment where we needed it. Made a couple practice runs out at Nanakuli, where we practiced taking the boats through the high surf there. And had a chance to go on leave in Honolulu. But there were so many sailors around that you couldn't walk down the street. It was so crowded. The sidewalk, I mean. Okay, we're back in Pearl Harbor after the Marianas operation. And we were advised this time we were going to Okinawa. We knew where we were going. Didn't know exactly what the role is, but there's a group of islands called the Karamareto, and I think they're on the south or on the west side of Okinawa. And our job was to reconnoiter those islands to see if they were fortified, and if so, how many troops were on. We got a new ship for this trip. It was a brand new destroyer escort. Can't remember the name of it. Chamberlain, maybe, something like that. Not quite that, but it was about the same size as the old World War I destroyer we were on before. But everything was new, had much better living accommodations and arrangements. On the World War I destroyer, the USS Waters, we ate out on the deck most of the time. That's where they served the food, sort of like a like they do at this picnic over here. There's a table set up there, and you walk by and got your food and ate where you could. But on the, we had a mess hall of sorts on the new ship we were on. And we head out of there. Again, we know where we're going. Went to Ulithi Harbor, which is a harbor, an atoll, like this pool table, only it's 20 miles across. And when you go in, you can see the brink of islands all the way around the horizon, but you can't really, they're only 15, 20 feet out of the water anyway, and it's so far away, you just know there's something there on the horizon. And there were 100 ships in there, biggest bunch of ships I've ever seen. We're there a couple days, and then we head for the Philippines. And we were in a convoy of about 60, 80 ships, I guess, then. And a lot of LSTs. And we were on the outer, the destroyers patrolled the outer limits of the convoy, which would be a 6 or 7 miles across. And with a ring of destroyers around the whole bunch as they moved. And we were, of course, a destroyer type, and we were out there on that. What, as passengers, we just watched everything. Did a little bit of calisthenics on the back deck whenever, every morning or in the evening, just to keep in shape. We went to Leyte in the Philippines. And Leyte was where MacArthur had just, he'd landed a week or 10 days before. It was still under, they were still, the Army groups were in there, the Marines weren't. And they were still pushing the Japanese into a corner on Leyte. But we went in there for 2 days rest before we went on. I guess rest, I don't know what else it was. We didn't do anything there, but we did make a practice run at night out there. One night I remember landing. Anyway, the thing I remember about Leyte is the smell. The Philippines had a different smell than any place that I remembered. There was anti-aircraft fire pretty regularly at night. Japs would send over one plane. Why, I don't know, but we had complete dominance of the air at that time. There a couple days back aboard, joined an even bigger armada. I think there were 400 ships. It was, I just read the other, not too long ago, that that was the biggest invasion fleet the world has ever known. It was the one that went to Okinawa. And we were part of that. There were ships every place. And we were back on that destroyer, which job was protecting the fleet. And things got a little hairy about that time because the Japs started using the kamikaze planes, pilots flying them in and crashing them into the ships. We were about a week out of there, I would think, before we got to Okinawa, because you don't move very fast when you got 400 ships in a convoy. And we got to Okinawa, and of course I don't know what happens to the fleet then, because I'm just not privy to that kind of information. We were sort of off by ourselves, and certainly we were at night, because our assignment then was to land at night on these islands. We made 5 landings in 7 nights in Karamareto Islands. And twice we got into difficulties. One night we landed on an island, and it had just a beautiful little cove about 150 yards across. And we went in there, and our 6 river boats and about 80 men, enough, 10, yeah, that's about it, and landed. And usually the one group set up around to protect the boats, the one platoon, and then one platoon went one direction and another went the other. And we started off, and we didn't know what was on the island. Got up off the beach, and all of a sudden there was an occasional mortar started falling on the beach. I looked back and could see them there. And we didn't go very far, I know, and then a machine gun opened up. I was where I could see that machine gun. I could see the mortars being fired. That's what I could see. Because it's the Japanese mortars, anyway, threw out a red light shot up in the air enough to see when they went off. And I could see those. They were about 500 yards away, I'd say. And there was a lot of confusion. Nobody knew what the hell we were going to do next, because we weren't prepared to really run into any kind of resistance like that. Our job was to get in and get out, find out what was there. But the 1st platoon and the 4th platoon, there were 4 platoons, and the 1st and the 4th, Sergeant Benko was from the 1st, and Sergeant Harner was from the 3rd, and then from the weapons platoon was a Sergeant Reeves. And they weren't far off the beach, and they, for some reason, those 3 guys wanted to huddle. They were the leaders of that platoon, the non-coms. They weren't the officers, but they had to have a little huddle about what they were going to do next. And while they were huddling, a mortar shell hit Sergeant Harner right in the head. And the other 2 were right there next to him. It killed Sergeant Benko and Harner. And Reeves was unconscious. And the decision was made, we're going to pull out and go back. Just pull out, because we're not prepared to fight a battle here. We know there's resistance here, and we know they got mortars. And we got back to the beach, and then somebody said, well, did they get Harner and the ones that were hit? I still wonder, and anytime I think about that, I wonder why in the hell the guys in those platoons didn't bring those guys in back with them, but they didn't. So I don't know whether they said we need somebody to go get them or how that came, but I know I was one of the 4 of us that went up there to get those, see what happened there. So we went back up that trail, and of course, I'd smartened up. I had my rifle with me then. I wasn't about to leave it like I did that one time. Anyway, went back up there. We found them. Horner doesn't have a head, and Benko's torn to pieces, and Reeves is still breathing. Didn't seem to be conscious, but and I don't know who made the decision. We leave the 2 dead ones and carry Reeves out. But that's what we did. I got Reeves by the feet, and this was a dark night. There was no moon. It was pitch dark that night. And Litch was with me again. He was my favorite person in the service. he was with me that night, and he had one arm, and I don't remember who else had the other arm of Reeves. And we started back to the beach with him. And I was in lead, carrying him at the feet, and I walked right off of a little cliff about 5 feet high. And we end up down at the bottom of that, everybody on top of me, all three men, and oh, I had picked up the rifles of Minko and the other partner. By the way, that's Judy's family name, partner. I've always wondered if there's a connection, but I think he was from Colorado, to the best of my knowledge. In any case, I picked up those rifles. I think I was carrying my own rifle plus two more. And that was quite a pile of crashing down there, but I don't remember feeling any pain at all from those guys landing on top of me. And we just scrambled out of there and picked up everything and went on. Got back to the beach, got them in the boat, got in the boats and paddled out of there. They didn't fire a shot at us as we were paddling away, and I never understood that, because we were completely at their mercy in this little cove there. If they'd had a machine gun on the bank, they would wipe us off. But we went back to the ship, just breaking daylight when we finally got out there. Our routine on that was you go out, and we had these lights that I, ultra, and I can't remember the other word there, so they could, you could see them, but only if you had the spatial scope. And we rendezvoused with the boat that was picking us up, and we had a long, heavy rope that hooked on the back of the boat and trailed out there about enough. It went under the first boat, under the second boat, under the third boat. And I think we had 5 boats on them. And a string of boats behind that landing craft. Hooked onto that rope and hauled back to the ship. That was that night. We made, as I said, 5 landings. There was one other one where we run into some home guards, but we didn't kill anybody, and they didn't kill any of us. I think they fled, and that's all we there. But we were able to report back that there was no significant opposition on that island. The reason that these islands were important was that the Japanese, I say, were starting to use the kamikazes and trying to bomb our troops when the invasion fleet, and this group of islands were in their way from coming from, and they wanted to set up anti-aircraft. We wanted to set up anti-aircraft guns on these islands so we could stop their incoming flights. That's what that was all about. And that's what they were used for. After about 5 nights of that, we were worn out. I can remember that. We were worn out. So we were going to be given a rest. And on one of those islands that we'd taken, they got some bulldozers ashore there to level off places for permanent anti-aircraft batteries and stuff. And they'd leveled off a place near a little village here, huts, several huts. And you guys got the perfect spot. Come in here and bed down. You'll be here for 3 days. You don't have to worry about anything. Well, that happened to be the town garbage dump that they'd leveled off. We had the worst infestation of fleas you have ever seen. They were all over us and everything we had. After 2 nights, it rained all the time too. Rained all the time. In a pup tent there, laying in the mud. A couple days or 3 days of that, and we're ready to go back aboard ship and head for wherever the hell they wanted us. And we did. Come aboard ship, fleas crawling all over us. Strip off. Through everybody went buck naked there on the fantail of the destroyer. Through this, had a burn barrel there. You just took off your clothes and threw them in the burn barrel. And they had a hose there, just like spraying a bunch of cattle. And they sprayed us down with disinfectant and flea killer and everything else and it got rid of them. And we all survived. It didn't hurt us any. I know it was kind of nasty. Issued us a new set of dungarees, socks, shoes, and we were ready to go. We had some other experiences on Okinawa, some of them good. One of the islands, we were sent ashore. We went, one of them we had been ashore initially. We went back on, and myself and two other guys in my fire group, I think I was a squad leader by that time. I would have been made a corporal when I got back back to Pearl Harbor after the Marianas. And anyway, I think there was myself and three others were assigned to guard a water distillation unit that was out on a little point of land on the southern tip of one of those islands. And it was a nice spot. It was a little beach there, and we couldn't see anybody else anyplace. Once in a while we'd see a ship out on the horizon. But a water distillation unit was a big piece of equipment, about half as big as a boxcar, that pumped ocean water through it, and you got fresh water out the spigot. And they needed the water for the radar and the anti-aircraft units that were a mile away up on the hill there. So we were guarding that unit for about 10 days there. So we had a vacation. We had to keep a 24-hour watch on the unit, but other than that, you're free to do what you damn please. And spent a lot of time swimming out in the ocean there on a little coral reef. It wasn't very far out. It was a pleasant time. We were eating 10-1 rations, I remember, which was about the best rations that were around, coming in big box, better than the K or the C rations. After about a week of that, let's see, yes, one other incident there. I think it was on that same island. Maybe it was another one. But they got word some way that there were some Japanese soldiers on the tip of the island there. And it was kind of mountainous island there. And so Carl was given full squad. There were six of us. And I was to go back there and take a tour down through those hills and see if I could find where those Japanese were. And we found traces of them. We found campfires where they'd been camping out, but we never saw a human being. And it was not an easy day, because we were carrying a lot. We were carrying ammunition and a rifle. And we weren't carrying packs other than just the essentials, because we weren't going to spend overnight. We were supposed to be back at night. And so I guess we walked 6-8 miles, something like that. And when you're out there on the alert like that, it's a little different just going out and hiking down a path, because it's more taxing anyway, let me put it that way. You feel like you've been someplace when you walk 6 miles under those circumstances. And came back around the end, and there was no beaches, but there was a long spit of coral that seemed to connect to where we wanted to go. And I didn't want to leave the main island. The rest of the group wanted to go out across that coral spit. It was shorter and easier. And I still don't know why I let them do that. But because I was supposed to be in charge of that group. But I said, okay, if you guys want to do that, but I'm going to go up over this hill here and go, and I'll meet you around there. They'd be pointing to where I was going to meet them. And so I went up over the hill and through the jungle. They went out, and I could see them most of the time. They were out there where I could see them. That's the reason I didn't want to go out there. I thought that was the wrong thing to do. But nevertheless, I guess I failed as a leader then, because I let them go. But they made all right. That wasn't a problem. But I was pretty damn anxious about that because I got back where I couldn't see them, and they weren't there where we were supposed to meet. And I was starting to panic then. And eventually, I think I climbed up the hill again to see where they were, and I could see them, and they were still coming. So I made it a lot quicker than they did, even though I had a much more difficult terrain to cover than what they did. Anyway, we got back, reported what had happened, and no problems came out of that. Except I was angry myself. I probably could have been shot for letting them go out there, but in any case, it worked out. Got one more tale about that. We landed on an island off Okinawa, and it was a little different than the other Karamareto Islands. It was a long, about 6 mile long, and rose about 300 feet or so out of the water. Just a long, what would you call it, molehill. And we went around them. One platoon stayed with the boats, and one platoon went around the north end of it, and one went around the south end. And as I recall, our job was to go around to the north end. And I was on the point most of that night, which means I was out in front because I was a squad leader. All right, we're in the latter days of Okinawa operation, and we made the landing on this island and spent most of the night. It was just coming daylight when we got around the north end of the island and got around. Actually, we were, I don't think we were back where we started, but they'd set up a command post up on the top of it, which was 300 or 400 feet elevation up from the ocean, not very far. It was steep banks there. And everybody was, we got back, and everybody else just flopped down because we'd been walking all night. And I'm still standing. I was the only one standing. And Taylor, the lieutenant, was, and he said, "Carl, you want to go with me?" And I always volunteered. When he said go, I'd go. And so he said, "Well, come on, let's go." He didn't even tell me where we were going, but he was going up the hill again, up to the top of the hill of the command post. And so I trot along behind him, and we get up there. And there was our company commander and his adjutant and a couple other officers there. And me, I'm standing there not saying a word, just watching, and it's just coming daylight. And the Japanese had, as I mentioned earlier, had started using the kamikaze boats, not the planes necessarily, but these were boats. And there were ships you could see quite a ways, probably could see from 4 or 5 miles in every direction from the top of that little island. And there were a lot of American ships out there, and there were a lot of these boats. No, not a lot of them. There were at least 5 of the boats out there trying to get to the American ships to just ram into them. And a lot of gunfire. The destroyers were all shooting at the boats, and the shells were bursting. They weren't bursting around us. We had a ringside seat. Nobody had a better view of what was going on. And we were standing there at that command post watching this battle take place. And it went on for 30 minutes at least, maybe longer than that. A lot of firing and a lot of... eventually, the ships, the kamikaze boats, usually got, I remember them being blown out of the water. But it didn't happen right away because they were kind of hard to hit with a piece of artillery, and that's what they were shooting at, well, their ship's guns. But, so it was a half-hour show there. That about ends Okinawa. Of course, at that point, we all knew that after Okinawa, the next was going to be Japan. But we happened to have the right commanding officer, Jones, and we're headed back to Pearl. Got back on our destroyer, No, we weren't on the destroyer. We were on another ship there. I don't remember which one. I think I was on 16 ships total during the war. Different ones. Three or four of them around the States. We got back, we head back to Pearl, got back to Lithia Harbor, and we were hanging around there for a week or so. Why, I don't know. But probably waiting to collect the convoy to head back to Pearl. But in any case, the war ended. Japanese surrendered. And the orders were, everybody's going to Japan. Every boat, ship, man, marine. And Jones said, I'm not taking my boys out there again, but we're going back. And so we got on the USS Johnson, a troop ship that had been built before the turn of the century. Made about 4.5 knots, which is a fast walk, and headed for Pearl Harbor on that. We had 120 men on a ship that would hold 1,700. So we had quite a lot of roomy accommodations and good food and good comfortable situation. No duties. War's over. We're heading back to Pearl. Took us about 3 weeks to get there. You could walk it almost. But we got back to Pearl. One of the small groups that was able to get back when everybody else was going to the other direction. Was in Pearl for a week or so, and we were heading on back to the States for a month's leave. We got on an LST, and it was another convoy. This next ocean voyage was one of the most hazardous ones of my experience. Got on this LST, which that's the landing ship tank, and they have a deck below. They're the ones where the doors open up in front of the ship, and there's a deck below and a huge ramp that allows the tanks that are up on the surface deck to go down and go through those same doors. And they just filled the whole tank deck of the LST with folding cots. And I ended up with the one right in the front, right at the exit, and that 60-ton ramp was hanging right over my head on two chains. And the LSTs aren't made for choppy water, but it was fairly choppy. We're into September, late September, when we made that voyage. Two LSTs and 16 small craft subchasers. Not nearly as big as the LSTs, but little ships that they use to chase subs around Pearl Harbor and other harbors. Anyway, a convoy of them. A convoy then, weren't in danger from the Japanese because the war was over, but they had to be refueled, those subchasers did, constantly. All the daylight hours on that trip, we were refueling the subchaser off the LSD, just one after the other. And it took us 2 weeks to go from Pearl to San Diego. I didn't spend a night in my bed because I was afraid to sleep under that damn big ramp that was hanging there, bouncing on a couple of chains. played bridge all night in the mess hall every night for the 2 weeks. Back to San Diego, about a week there getting ready. We're given a month's leave, get on a train. Took us a week to get to Chicago. Stopped at every other crossing between San Diego and Chicago. There were two cars of Marines. I'd say there were about 40 of us on that little trip. And everybody fanned out. Every time we'd stop at the train station, everybody would fan out looking for liquor stores. And a lot of drinking. Happy time. Except for the hangovers. Back to Pearl, or back to Chicago. And we had a night to kill there before we left for a train to Indianapolis, to Ohio, through Indianapolis. And Jack, Whaley, and I walking around there in the park out on the next to the Lake Michigan and joined up with a couple girls. And by this time, the weather, we're into October, first 10 days of October, later even. And it's chilly. And I don't remember ever being any colder than I was standing out there with that young lady on the shore of Lake Michigan. Then I just couldn't get over it. Of course, we'd been down there where it was hot for 2 years, and there was something different about coming back here in the cold weather. But I survived that night. Next morning, caught a train out of there for Cincinnati, out of Chicago. It was so crowded, couldn't get inside the car. I was standing on the link that connects two cars. Now it was closed in with some sliding partitions there, but we weren't in the car, it was too full. And I stood up in that outside the car there and then link between them for all the way to Indianapolis, and then some people got off and I got a seat. And rode into Cincinnati the next morning. Hitchhiking out of train station in Cincinnati for Edenton, and who should come along, pick me up, but Hazel and Arthur. And Arthur had been discharged by this time, and Polly was in the hospital with giving birth to Kathy. And they picked me up, took me home. But the most interesting thing about that is that when I came home out of boot camp 2 years earlier, the same thing happened. Only I think it was Hazel that picked me up when I was hitchhiking home. And Polly was in the hospital giving birth to Rachel. I'm home. I'm not going to tell you about my experiences that month's leave at home, because nothing that's worth note. But we had a great time. I did. Floyd Allen was home then. He was my best friend. We weren't in the service together, even though we had enlisted together. But he'd been on Okinawa at the same time I was, but I didn't even know that, and he got shot up there pretty badly, and he was recovering. One thing about I remember about that month at home there, Floyd had a girlfriend up at Athens University in Ohio, and he said, well, he had access to his dad's car, and so we drove to Athens, Ohio to see his girlfriend. Floyd's mouth was wired shut because his jawbone had been shattered with that bullet he'd taken. And we got up there to to Athens and went, rounded up his girlfriend, and she fixed me up with the date. But Floyd's girlfriend had her mouth wired shut too. She'd been in a car accident and broken her jaw. So the two of them, by the time the month was over, I had to report back. I had orders to report back to Washington, D.C., to the Guard Battalion and there in Washington. That sounded exciting, and the only reason when I got that was because of the pull that our Landing Officer Jones had had. He, I don't know why, but a few of us got assigned up there. Got into Washington, D.C. About the first day or second day I was there, they asked me what my plans were, and I said, well, I'm here, what do I need to do? And they said, well, do you want to be discharged? And I thought about that about 10 seconds and said, yep. So they said, okay, you won't be given any duties here. I hung around there at the barracks, which was right at the base of the Washington Monument, for about a week, I think, and then shipped off to Quantico, which is 35 miles south, and was there about a week. And then on December the 5th, I was discharged from the Marine Corps at Quantico. Little did I know that 30 some years later, I'd be living right outside the base gates of Quantico. That's where that house, and build a house out there at Montclair Country Club. That ended my military career.